Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS Current Affair Analysis for 31st December 2019, and these are the articles that we'll be dealing today. The first article for the day is taken from the Hindu and it is titled For a Personal Healing Touch. National Health Policy talks about three aspects of healthcare: accessibility, affordability and quality. So in order to ensure this, Niti Aayog came up with a 15-year framework for health services delivery. It is titled Health Systems for a New India, Building Blocks, Potential Pathways to Reform. It talks about certain aspects which are very important from national health policy perspective. There is a proposal to consolidate small practices into larger business-like organizations. That is the most problematic one. Now, before getting into the problem, let us look at the positive signs of this report. It talks about something like elimination of informality, merging of fragmented risk pools, and reduction of out-of-pocket expenditure. Now, what do you understand by merging of fragmented risk pool? It generally means if young people take more and more number of insurance policies, the old can be compensated with less premium charges. So, it is taking the law of averages into consideration while delivering the public service for everyone. Now, the author compares the present proposal from Niti Aayog with the way healthcare system developed in US in the 20th century. If you look at the history of evolution of the healthcare industry in the US, it started from an informal nature and grew into large conglomerates which commodified healthcare services. So, as a result, if you look at the present state of healthcare, in the US, it ended up as one of the most impersonal healthcare systems. There is hardly any personal interaction or personal rapport that the doctor tries to maintain with the patient, and there is a growing perception that healthcare is just another commodity. So, the general trend in India has always been that most of the healthcare providers have less than 10 employees. So, they are decentralized small local units catering to small set of individuals, and this is seen as a problem for Indian healthcare service. So in a way, Niti Aayog is proposing what is generally called as economics of scale in normal production based economy. So if you are trying to apply this logic to healthcare, it is a problematic issue because we are trying to dehumanize the entire healthcare delivery. According to WHO, healthcare is not just about ensuring the absence of disease, but it is also about ensuring a state of well-being. So this includes both mental as well as physical. So when you are trying to dehumanize the healthcare delivery, all it ends up is hurting the patient more than benefiting him. So, this is not the kind of model that we should be emulating as per the author. When you look at it, small clinics have certain advantages because they ensure mental satisfaction to the patients. They ensure regular follow-ups, and this better follow-ups will automatically translate into better clinical outcomes. And this is proved by a lot of research studies as well. It has been proved that patient-doctor relationship is very crucial for better healthcare outcomes, and this is proved by many studies. So, in this context, if you are trying to dehumanize the healthcare delivery, the healthcare plan will not have any significance. So, it is not a supermarket where you can just go and pick up a commodity and ensure payment for that. Healthcare is much beyond that, and there is a human element attached to it because most of the patients are very distressed about their ill health. So, you need a positive rapport and you should trust the doctor. And the doctor should empathize with the suffering of the patient. And this is what makes the life of doctors very tough. Policymakers are right when they focus upon issues like lack of funds or manpower. But suggesting a solution which is practical in the short term will have long-term consequences. For example, when the 20th century capitalists saw there is some profit involved in the healthcare service in US, the healthcare industry has never turned back towards empathy. It has always been a commodity which is meant to be served to the patients. So every care must be taken to ensure that India is not repeating the same mistake. That is the gist of this article. The second article for the day is titled Guarantee Internet Rights, and this is in the context of the internet shutdowns. This is taken from the Hindu. So recently, some decisions of the union government, such as the abrogation of Article 370 or the Kashmir issue or the Citizenship Amendment Act, have led to violent protest in parts of the country, and this has forced the administration to suspend internet services to prevent rumor mongering. Recently, there was a study which analyzed internet shutdowns in the country and found that terror activities and communal tensions have been the biggest contributors to suspension of services. So, data prepared on internetshutdowns.com showed that there were more than 350 plus internet shutdowns since 2014. And if you look at the timeline, India witnessed 6 shutdowns in 2014. It rose to 14 in 2015. In 16, it was 31. In 17, it was 79. And in 18, it reached a peak of 134. And by December 15, 2019, there were around 93 shutdowns. So if you look at this data, the number of internet shutdowns have increased many fold in the last 5 years. So according to Shutdown Tracker Optimization Project data, a website which is based on internet activism, 67% of the world's internet shutdowns in 2018 happened in India. 67% is a staggering number. Now, this author tries to focus upon the laws on which these internet shutdowns were imposed. The first one is the Section 144 of the CRPC. We have dealt this issue in our previous videos. Please go through them. And the next one is the Indian Telegraph Act of 1885. And Section 5 Clause 2 talks about the power of the state to impose internet shutdowns. And the most staggering fact is some of the internet shutdowns were imposed without any legal provisions and just by executive order. Now, this is a problematic issue, and let us have a look at the reasons why this is a problematic issue. Let us first look at the economic impact of an internet shutdown. According to the Indian Council for Research on International Economic Relations, as well as several agencies from the OECD and US-based Brookings Institute, looked into this aspect and said that as much as $3 billion were lost in India, 16,315 hours worth of internet shutdown. And due to the 12,600 hours worth of mobile internet shutdown, the telecom industry has supposedly lost $2.37 billion. So for a country which is aiming to become a 5 trillion economy and wants to anchor the growth on its IT and communication sector, this is a bad news, and it will send all the wrong signals to investors and consumers. We also have e-commerce, which is poised to touch $150 billion by 2020. It makes business sense to leave the web as open as possible. So, there is a recommendation that the primary driver of entrepreneurship in India would be IT. And IT is based on internet. Without internet, we cannot progress and we cannot reach the 5 trillion economy target that we have set for ourselves. And the second dimension to this internet shutdown issue is the rights angle. According to Article 21, Right to Life, internet access is a part of life. And the same has been reiterated in the Fahima Shirin case, where the Kerala High Court held that, citing the Human Rights Council of the UN, which found that right to access to internet is a fundamental freedom. So the High Court decided that it is a tool for educational empowerment of women and ensured that nobody can deny this right. Another contentious issue is the Article 19, which clearly gives the right to freedom of expression. Now, imposing an internet shutdown is a way of thwarting the voice of journalists, because without internet, publishing and accessing information where the speed of gathering information is very crucial is based on internet. This is the gist of this article. The next article for the day is taken from Indian Express and it is titled Freedom from 3Cs. In this context, we have to note that the credit growth has hit one of the lowest points in the history of banking industry. One of the reasons cited for this is the overzealousness of the investigative agencies of the state on the alleged corruption of bankers, due to which there has been a rise in non-performing assets. So, in order to reach out to the fears expressed by the Indian Banking Association, the finance minister has reached out to the banks and ensured that they will not be punished for taking right decisions and ensuring credit growth. Recently, our ex-Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh has raised an issue that the present attitude of the government is to consider everyone as corrupt unless proven otherwise, and this is it's a cause of concern because it is hurting our economic prospects due to inaction from the state agencies. In a reply for this, there was an interesting article which we covered in Live Mint, which spoke about good corruption as well as bad corruption. Now, what is good corruption? Good corruption is the corruption, according to that particular author in Live Mint article, where the corruption will ensure efficiency. Our structural deficiencies have triggered this case of good corruption, and bad corruption is the case where, due to harassment of officials, the inefficient systems are causing troubles to the common public. As an extension to what Dr. Manmohan Singh said, India has currently taken a tough stance against corruption, and as a result, we have attack the good corruption as well, and this is causing the problem of inefficiency due to inaction. So, an answer for this will be not just addressing the causes of fear for state agents, but also to carry out structural reforms. Now, in an extension to that article, this article specifically talks about how we have to privatize our banking sector to take away the fear of CBI, CVC and CAG, because private sector runs on profit motive. And sticking to the motto of the present government, that is minimum government, maximum governance, it should ensure that the private sector also plays a role in the developmental needs of the country. So, for example, there were apprehensions against privatization where private banks may not cater to rural population and hence thereby making financial inclusion a problematic issue. So, in order to address these kind of concerns, private banks should be incentivized and profits should be ensured because of the economies of scale. We have huge unserved populations, and such kind of populations with the help of technology and private sector can reap in huge benefits. So, not just taking away the fear of CBI, CVC and CAG, the private sectors should also be encouraged, and if that is not possible, there should be immediate structural reforms in the form of governance. So, these governance reforms must be aimed at solving the confidence issues of the bankers as well and not just the consumers. That is what this article is trying to say. The next article for the day is taken from Indian Express and it is titled Challenge Lies Within. This is written by C. Rajmohan and it is an important article. Traditionally, the two important pillars of Indian diplomacy were the growing economic strength and, more importantly, its soft power. So both these pillars are under stress right now, and this has been hurting our diplomatic leverage as well. The main reason for our soft power is because of our democratic values, and this can be seen in the form of support from the West, especially the US, in times of crisis, like when we received support despite the fact that we tested a nuclear bomb, or the 2008 nuclear deal despite not signing the NPT or not being a part of many of the arrangements like NSG. All this is because of our democratic values. Now, what are these democratic values? They actually emphasized India's ability to coexist with different cultures and celebrate the diversity and yet remain unified. That is what we call the spirit of unity and diversity. So that has been our strength. Now, coming back to the first pillar of economic strength, due to the global economic slowdown and in the inherent structural deficiencies of our systems itself, there is a protracted economic slowdown which is limiting the commercial prospects or attractiveness of India as an investment destination. So the two broad themes that are impacting our international diplomacy are the sharp rise in the religious division within the country and the persistent confrontation with Pakistan. This has been hurting our international image. So theoretically, India is a sovereign country. We cannot take decisions in isolation, and we have to consider our historical facts, political ideologies, and the geographical situations and the place where we are set up. Additionally, in the 21st century, even technology and economy in the form of trade are impacting our sovereign decisions. So, though theoretically we are independent, our sovereignty is not exactly uninfluenced by all these factors. So, to say that we can take whatever decisions we want without taking into considerations the external factors would not be a wise form of policy making. Why do I say this? Take the example of Russia or Qatar, which are trying to take advantage of the internal deficiencies in other economies as well as political geographies. So, these countries are accused of using the disadvantages of a country against itself. So, in a similar way, nothing can be as sensationalistic as a religious conflict. So, it will automatically draw a lot of international attention, and India must act to ensure that this image is not circulated internationally and must act in all the directions and use all the tracks of diplomacy to avoid this. The last article for the day is titled "A World Without Capitalism is Not Too Hard to Envision." This is taken from the Live Mint, and it throws light on what is the requirement of new mode of capitalism and why the old forms of capitalism has failed. The old form of capitalism always focused on maximizing profits without any considerations for social benefits. With the advent of corporate social responsibility, corporates began to take up some philanthropic activities to showcase their love towards society. However, there is a criticism that even corporate social responsibility is another name for brand building. Also, there was this trend of using tradable shares in markets and increased borrowing with a hope to make profits and repay it in the future is considered to be an unsustainable way of raising capital. In this context, the author proposes that we have to create a new corporate law. What are the facets of this new corporate law? This should move the capitalism from present structure to what is envisioned as stakeholder capitalism, which closely resembles a democracy. Now, each stakeholder gets one vote, as in a proper electoral democracy, and he will decide on each and every aspect of the organization. It is a duty of the people running the organization to guide the less relevant stakeholders in decision making so that they make an informed decision. So this will ensure that there will be equal distribution, and this will protect the interests of all the stakeholders and thus protect the positive concept of capitalism. This is the gist of this article. That's it for the day. Thank you.